Good evening and Merry Christmas. We are extremely happy that you are here, and this is a wonderful tradition just to be together for a short amount of time to just really focus on Christ's birth. And so we're not going to keep you long tonight, but we're going to pack some information in here and just an opportunity to praise God together. If you did not get a candle on your way in this evening, there are still some available out in the main lobby just right through the double doors. You are more than welcome to go grab one if you did not. Let's pray and we'll get started. God, we thank you for Christ. And God, we thank you for moments like this, when we get to slow down and we get to focus. And God, we pray that you will bless this time. We pray that you will bless each family who is here tonight. God, we pray for those who were not able to be here tonight for various reasons. And God, we know that even though this is a time of joy and peace, God, we know that that isn't everyone's experience. And so we pray for those tonight who are hurting and who are lonely. And God, we pray that you will bring them comfort and that you will exchange just negative gifts of pessimism and misery and drama and all of those negative things. We pray that you will exchange those for great things like joy and hope and love and peace. We pray all those things in Jesus' name tonight. Amen.
We live in a world that's full of drama. And from a distance, drama looks nice. It looks entertaining. In fact, many times we'll turn on a television show we watch just for the drama, or we go to a movie just to see the drama play out. But if when drama it happens in our own life, it begins to exhaust us, and it begins to make us lose hope. This Christmas season, I want you to know that Jesus will bring us hope. It was predicted in the Old Testament that he would bring us, peace. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7 says this: "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." And Jesus himself tells us he's going to bring us peace. In John 14, 27, he says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Jesus offers us the gift of peace.
Touch their hearts of gold. For many of us, this is a great time of the year. It's a time of excitement and anticipation. A time of the year where there's always something to look forward to. And most of us would say, for now, life is pretty good. But then we turn the calendar and January shows up, and it's months before warm weather, days without sunshine, and the gloom of life begins to push our joy away. Jesus knew this. Jesus knew there would be days like this. And he gave us this promise in John 15. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in me, in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full.
In John chapter 10, verse 10, says this. The Apostle John writes the words of Jesus. It says, "The thief," that's the devil, "comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come to give you life and have it to the full." And I know that scripture is not, it's not part of our catalog of Christmas scriptures, but it really ought to be, because it tells, I mean, this is the time we celebrate the coming of Christ to this planet. And this scripture really tells us why, or at least one of the reasons why. The devil's out there reaching all kinds of destruction, and he still is. But Jesus has come to give, to teach, to serve, to give his life so that we can have life. And that sounds like good news and hope and glad tidings, right? There's a message of hope in that verse. I'm going to share something ridiculous with you. It's one of these things that, if you hear it, you just kind of go, whatever. Kind of like what the pessimist would do. And it comes out of the book of, or the letter to the Thessalonian church, chapter 5. The Apostle Paul writes, "Be thankful in every circumstance." Be thankful in every circumstance. Who can really do that? Who can do that? I mean, isn't that impossible? It's possible if your hope is in Jesus. Isaiah chapter 42 writes this prophecy about Jesus. It says, he says, a bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. It's this idea that this wick is about to go out, but just somebody comes along and just kind of fans it back into existence, wafts it back into to a full flame. And he goes on and says, "In his teaching, they will put their hope." It says, "in his teaching." And just when it feels like that, when life is just kind of smoldering out and you're, whatever you're dealing with in the midst of your difficult days, Jesus will come alongside you and just kind of bring back to life your sanity and your energy and whatever you're struggling with. It was on this day 7 years ago, Christmas Eve, where my wife and I spent, we were at Children's Mercy Hospital in Kansas City when our young daughter, McKenna, at the time, was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And that's how we spent our Christmas that year. And then later on, our youngest son, Asher, a couple years later, was diagnosed with the very same thing. And it would be a stretch for me to say that I'm thankful for that situation. I don't think any parent would be able to say that, but I can profess to no end how thankful I am that God came alongside me and my wife and helped us through and gave us the right perspective of what we were dealing with and who he was and who we are and the difficult days that we experienced through that. And 7 years removed from McKenna and 5 years removed from Asher, I can say thank you so much, God, for coming alongside and giving us hope. But it's a daily process, and Paul lays that out real quick here. He lays it out in Romans chapter 5. He says, we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character leads to hope. And hope does not disappoint. And Jesus will walk through your difficult days with you. God is with us. And I think that has something to do with Christmas. Emmanuel.
Angels. During the holidays, the blame game is in full swing, not just with others, but many times even with ourselves, blaming ourselves for lack of time, resources, planning, preparation, even blaming ourselves for not enjoying the holidays because of all those things. Going back to that very first Christmas, I would guess when they got into town and he hadn't called ahead for a hotel room, there might have been some blame game. And yet, aren't we called to love? Isn't that what this entire season about? Just loving people, including yourself? It's okay to love. That's what the whole Christmas story leads to, the love of a creator for his creation, the gift of his son, a baby so easy to love, full of love, bringing love, restoring love. Deuteronomy 7:9 says it like this: "Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is a faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments." Also in Luke 10, Jesus says it like this: "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself."
Sin and
And so all that brings us to tonight, Christmas Eve. And all night, you may have noticed that we've been lighting the Advent candles off the white middle candle. And many of you know, and many of you may not, that middle candle, the white one, is known as the Christ light. And you see, the whole reason for the season, as we say, is Jesus. But it's not just the fact that Jesus came as a baby. If you're a parent, you know that when a baby enters the world, it's exciting. But the truth is, you have to take that thing home. And that changes a lot. The story of Christ coming as a baby, it is amazing, but it's only a story that God could orchestrate. And the reason why we celebrate Christmas isn't just because a baby was born. It's what that baby brought into the world. And as Jesus grew, and as he taught, and as he healed, and as he performed miracles, he brought peace and joy and hope and love into the world in a way that it had never seen those things before. Jesus comes into the dark and he brings light. Galatians 4 says this: "When the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship." And in Romans 5, we read this: "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into his grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God." He says, hope, it doesn't put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That's us. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you that you came at just the right time through your son Jesus. God, we thank you that Jesus entered the world just like the rest of us did. He came as a baby. He didn't stay that way. He grew, he matured into a man, and through that whole process, God, he continued to pour out these gifts that we've talked about, gifts of peace and joy and hope and love. And God, that is why we celebrate tonight. And so, God, as we go out from here, we pray that we will share those gifts with others, that we will put aside the drama, that we will put aside the misery and the pessimism and the blame, and instead we will be adopted as your children who share peace and hope and joy and love. It's in Christ's name we pray tonight. Amen. Now is the time for you to get that candle out. We are going to light one another's candles, beginning with this Christ light. We encourage you to just pass that light all over the auditorium and use that as a reminder that as you go out into this world that is a dark place, that Christ has given you his light to share with others.
Thank you. as we sing two verses of Silent Night.
Merry Christmas. We encourage you, as you leave tonight, there will be the totes out in the main lobby if you will return your candles there. We hope that you have an amazing Christmas, spending it with family and friends, and continue to share that light with others. Let's pray and we'll get out of here. God, we praise you and we thank you for your love. We thank you for the light that is on a hill, that is not hidden, that is shared with everyone. And God, we thank you for the reminder tonight that light permeates the darkness. It makes it flee. And so we thank you for sharing that light with us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Merry Christmas.